Welcome back. Welcome back, everyone. WIBG 390-1020, the Welcome Home Show. We have Lieutenant Colonel Adam
Miklovis.
Miklovis.
Yes.
And don't worry about it. I don't get anybody's name right. You know, I got your name right, though, yeah. T. You got a project that's near and dear to this show's heart, and we've been following this program long before we came on the air, almost 6 years ago, at Reads Across America. Tell us what that's all about.
The Reach Across America is a organization that was founded in 1992 in Maine, and what they have been providing for Arlington National Cemetery is many wreaths that they could find sponsors for every year since then, where last year they provided almost 500,000 wreaths.
They blanketed the entire cemetery.
Yes.
That was the owner of
the cemetery. That's the intention. Well, last year was our first year in providing wreaths for the Cape May County Veterans Cemetery. We were able to get 300 wreaths placed honoring the veterans last year. And this year we're hoping to blanket many more.
We should be able to blanket the whole cemetery. Didn't you agree, Bill?
The Veterans Cemetery?
Yes, in Cape May.
Definitely.
No. What?
Well, of course, we can't tell you how many are buried there because the county doesn't know.
And I'd like to know, we need to get the politicians there and let them pick which grades get a wreath and which ones don't. And then let them tell the families, well, we don't have enough money. We claim about taking in $10 billion in tourism down here. What's a few thousand dollars to buy wreaths? You know, and I want to let everyone know, there's a family buried there. Charles Crescent and Mary McLaughlin got married. They have 5 sons. And their second oldest, Michael, is a Medal of Honor recipient. They're buried in that cemetery. And that cemetery, that grass should be looking like Arlington, not look like some old cow pasture. We got to fix that up, and we got to blanket that. And Chaplain Miles Barrett is a good friend of ours.
Yes.
He's involved in this program with you. And it's not that hard of a deal to do. They blanket 305,000 graves in less than 4 hours in Arlington. I think, what is it, the second Saturday of December?
The third Saturday of December. This year is the 16th of December. And at noontime, they have the commemoration ceremony, remembrance, across the nation. All of the veteran cemeteries have about 60,000 people out there putting wreaths on the graves.
And they do it overseas.
Yes. Wherever we have American troops buried, like Normandy and in Belgium, they're basically across the world, wherever we have our men.
And we want to thank you, Van. We're going to help you with that, because that program is near and dear to our heart. Ambassador Tull.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
How would you go to a cemetery and you got 5,000 people buried there and you only got 3,000 wreaths?
Well, I think we could do better than that.
You know, when Wayne Merritt started this, well, Wayne Merritt now is one of the vice presidents of Reads Across America. And the way this got started was the owner up in Maine had 5,000 wreaths left that they didn't sell. And he called a state senator up and says, hey, do you know anybody in Washington? We don't want to throw them away. So they put them on the oldest 5,000 graves. And then every year, till they got sponsors, they worked from the newest graves to the oldest grave. You lost a relative in Iraq, didn't you? Iraq,
yes.
Afghanistan?
I did, Iraq.
How old was he?
22.
And he was a helicopter pilot, correct?
Not a pilot, but he was a crew member.
Crew member. And he was a young man, wasn't he?
22
years old.
Young Marine.
You know? And I know the veterans are near and dear to your heart, Ambassador.
Absolutely.
What do you think about this lady that wants to put a memorial up?
I just think that is wonderful. I really do. I look forward to seeing it. Barnegat is not that far away, so when it's completed, I would look forward to going up and visiting it.
Yeah, we would love to have you there. Right now, the design is being reviewed by our local military organizations like the VFW and the American Legion in Barnegat. And so we're hoping that that gets approved soon and that we'll have it built and installed so that we could have a dedication ceremony by Veterans Day of this year, which is on a Saturday. So that's good because that's going to be able to enable a lot of people who normally work during the week to be able to come and bring their kids and talk about why this is important. Why is building a Vietnam Veterans Memorial important? You know, a lot of people, unfortunately, I'm finding, are not really aware even of some of the treatment that the Vietnam veterans had received when they came back. They're so far removed from it. So this is a good opportunity to be able to open up some frank discussions about that.
Now, are you talking about this year or next year?
This year. This year.
Wow, that is really moving forward.
Yes, it is. Well, Barnegat is a smaller town, so, you know, because there's not a lot of hands in the pot, so to speak, we're able to get things moving pretty quickly. That's what I'm hoping.
Well, T, what do you do for a living?
I am a project manager for Canon USA.
Yeah, do you have a title?
A project manager.
Yeah. Are you like a vice president or a
No, far from that. I'm just the really annoying girl who pushes people to get stuff done.
You must have it. So I guess that's enough saying that memorial will be up by Veterans Day.
If I make a decision to do something, I kind of go forward 100 miles an hour with it. So yeah.
Ambassador Tull, we're trying to get Lucy Noland on the phone. We keep getting, she works for Fox 29 News. She was born in Saigon, in the Saigon hospital. Her father worked in the embassy and met her mother, and they got married, and she was born, and she came back to the state, and we're trying to get Lucy. Mm-hmm. I know she works on the weekend, but we're going to continue to try and get her.
Okay.
How did you feel about us leaving Vietnam?
Well, I was extremely disappointed. I was upset. It seemed to me we were not keeping a very strong commitment we had made. And, I really felt we had cheated the people that accepted our offers and our promises. Now, when I left Saigon, I went over to Thailand and just sat on a beach for a few days and mourned. I really was in mourning. And I told my family and friends back here in the States that when I come back, this is not going to be a topic of discussion for me. It's never going to be cocktail hour chit-chat. I mean, I was in mourning, no question about it.
Ambassador Bill Davenport here. You say when you left Vietnam, you went to Thailand for an assignment or just some time?
No, just to recuperate. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, see, when I left, at the end of my tour there, I had about 2 months of, I guess we're called home leave, but I had leave that was optional. So I was meeting a friend. This was long planned, meeting a friend and taking a long leisurely trip. And so she was coming over. We were going to meet in Thailand. And I said, okay, but I'm going to go. I just can't do anything right now. So I went to Pattaya, lovely beach resort. And I just stayed there for 3 or 4 days and then got together with my friend in Bangkok. And we went on from there. I might say that when I asked my brother and his wife if they would take the children, I said that now I'm canceling my trip. You know, that's off. I won't be doing that. So as soon as I leave, I'll be home. And they said, don't do it. You don't know what you're getting into. You're a single woman and you're suddenly acquiring 3 children. No, take the trip. We'll take care of the children.
Did the U.S. government provide you with any post-Vietnam medical or mental care?
Oh, no.
Are you were you eligible?
There was not even an after action report. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like an assessment, not of my physical or any of our physical well being, but like what went wrong? What did you do? I fully expected when I did get back to Washington, there would be a review.
Well, I would think so.
What happened? And there was nothing.
A group coming off a patrol would have to fill out that kind of a report and probably be interviewed directly.
Nothing.
You'd think somebody at that level would really want to know about the history of what happened. And that was more history than an everyday activity.
Well, particularly like what made me think that it was time to evacuate Da Nang. I mean, I was in charge at that point.
Yeah.
And I made the recommendation and I was supported, but I really thought, okay, I'll have a few things to answer to. Back in Washington. No, it was just like Now put it away. It's gone.
Well, it certainly wasn't your fault. And you certainly, reading your book and knowing you, you certainly did everything you could in your power to make that an efficient event at both places, Da Nang and Saigon.
Yeah. No, I was very satisfied with my performance, not with the fact that we had to do it. You know what I mean? But no, it just seemed to me strange that there wasn't a, you know, some thorough assessment by the U.S. government of the military and of the civilians as to, okay, you know, what went wrong. But, I mean, if there was, I was not aware of it. And given my position, I would have thought if there was one that I'd have been involved in it. But nope.
Well, let's hope someday to, people are reading the book so the future is not the same as the past. Are you eligible for VA care? Or did they consider, do you have, did the government provide you with any kind of health care? Or?
No, I have Medicare, you know, because I'm 65. Mm. I'm over 65. No, I don't have. I had no access to any veterans benefits, and I can't go to any bases, you know, like, you know, and buy the PXs or anything of that nature.
Whoa, wait a minute! You're not allowed in the PX?
Like, oh no, not at all.
They are idiots down there in Washington. Let me tell you.
No, not allowed.
Wait a minute. Your rank? What is your rank as an ambassador equivalent to the rank of, like, a general?
Well, as an ambassador, my personal rank, and the fact I was an ambassador, I was the equivalent of a major general, two-star general.
Now that's pretty high up, and you should have been recognized for that. And you're right, there should have been an after-action thing. And, you know, you are a member of our Vietnam chapter that has the wall
right,
a while.
Right,
a proud member, and I say it all the time to our members and when I introduce you. None of our veterans spent 7 years in Vietnam. You certainly...
was off and on. You know, I did get back to the States in between, but it was...
Wait a minute. They weren't 6 month or 3 month tours. You did 3 years, 68, 69, and 70 around there during the Tet Offensive, and then you went back after you went to the War College in Washington.
Yes,
then you went back to Da Nang for 2 years, and then in 83, 84, and 85, you went to Laos. How many Marines, when you went to Laos, now you got to remember, we just got done bombing Laos for the last 10 or 12 years, and we probably bombed them as much as we did Vietnam.
More.
How many Marines did you take with you to Laos?
Oh, we had no military whatsoever.
Who'd you go with?
Well, by myself. We had an American staff at the embassy then of eight Americans, and we had a fairly substantial Laos staff who were, you know, carried over from the days when we had a lot more going on there. But no, we never had Marine Guards. I didn't have Marine Guards when I was ambassador to Brunei, for that matter. That decision is made on a case-by-case basis. Now, in the case of Laos, there's no way the Laos government would have allowed a single American military person in there on a full-time basis.
We got to go to a break in a minute, but I want to get this question out to you first, and then, Johnny, then we'll go to... We have to go to a break. We'll go to a break. You do all this time in Vietnam. How the hell did you end up in Laos?
Well, because I had the expertise of Indochina.
Who asked you to go?
The position of chargé d'affaires came up, and that's the chief of mission position. And I was due for rotation, so I applied for the job. And, you know, they had a look at my background, you know, that I had all this experience in Vietnam and a master's degree in Southeast Asian studies and all this good stuff. And I met with the assistant secretary, who was then Paul, the assistant secretary for East Asia. Paul Wolfowitz was his name. And he was being interviewed, and he was interviewing various people for the job. And he didn't seem initially thrilled at the thought of taking me, but I had been highly recommended by the assistant secretary for whom I had been working, Elliot Abrams. At that point, he was assistant secretary for human rights. And anyway, he put a recommendation in, and so I got the job. And so I was there for 3 years.
But wait a minute, before we go, they were still a 99% communist country, right?
100.
Well, I was including the missionary family, the father, mother, and the daughter, and your people that went with you.
But that was the only American that
yeah,
we had.
We got to go to a fast break. But you went over there and you did the first two successful digs of downed pilots that are still coming home today from Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam. Hold on, Ambassador. You listen to Welcome Home Show. We'll be right back.
I will.